Hey, welcome to Volume 3 of the Household Games Couchcast for tonight. Joined by special guest tonight, Benjamin Rivers.
We're going to play some Castlevania IV. Super Castlevania IV.
We are going to be playing some Super Castlevania IV. And as we go, we're going to be talking about world building. We're going to be talking about kind of the importance of this game, what kind of an impact this game has had on us. And hopefully some insights from Ben into how that's kind of influenced you and what you've worked on over the years.
Mm-hmm. This is the 25th anniversary of this game too, right? Same launch year as the Super NES? Launch window at least?
Yeah, definitely launch window, yeah.
For North America?
Yeah.
When's the first time you played this game?
I played this right around the time it came out.
Did you own a Super NES, like day one?
The holiday season of. I got one for Christmas the year of.
This was the first game system I ever bought with my own money.
Oh, man.
And I skipped work to do it. I skipped the last 10 minutes of work to do it. There's no help me code in this, is there?
There's not. Not
is
that
there,
I know.
Is there a secret code in this? I really don't know. Let's call ourselves... Let's make this really meta. Let's call ourselves... Oh, I don't know how this thing works. What is the... Is it start?
No, use A.
Oh, yeah.
Perfect.
It's foreshadowing. Will it fit? Oh,
just
yeah.
Barely. Perfect. But that's what was really annoying about this game was the passwords you use, the grid-based icon passwords had to match the file name.
Oh, really?
The character, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Because it would change the password it would give you. So if someone would tell you, password to level 9 is like... Holy water, holy water.
Right.
And then on the second line, blank space, heart, and then blank space, axe. But you didn't put in the right name or the name they used, it wouldn't work.
I didn't know that.
So
that makes sense. That's why, like, GameFAQs will have
they would
names.
Say, yeah, they're like, look, use this name and then put in this password.
I just remember the first time I played, look at that skull. That's amazing.
I do love that skull. And I love this drawbridge. This is my favorite Castlevania game.
This is my favorite Castlevania game, too. That's why we're friends.
Excellent. Perfect. That's perfect taste.
This music, this opening music is bananas. Still one of the best soundtracks in the system. I still think one of the greatest video game soundtracks of all time.
Easily,
and
yeah.
It was a launch window game.
Yeah.
Like, right.
The Super Nintendo launch is just unmatched.
Yeah.
It's just like, it still hasn't been beaten, I think.
So I remember playing this stuff and seeing that they were just... throwing all this stuff at you that you just had never seen before. Like, this whole game is just a tech demo. And just how fun it must have been to make this.
Yeah.
To say, hey, can you just put everything that the system does? Because we just need this to be as cool as possible.
Mm-hmm. There's some fantastic Mode 7 coming up.
Like, it's pointless.
But
I just love this. Like, just Mario World is the same thing, right?
Yeah. But it's really interesting that you said tech demo. That I find really great. Because nowadays... tech demo is kind of almost used as a derogatory term.
Yeah.
Like, someone will say, like, oh, that game is just a tech demo.
Yeah.
But that didn't used to be the case. That used to be, like, it used to be a good thing, because you were really showing off new things, but they build really strong games around that.
Yeah, well, I mean, kind of like most, this is, like, the only place in the whole game where there's a blinking set of eyes above a doorway.
Yeah.
And I always thought, there must be something with that. There never is, though. But, yeah, this was the game where they kind of just said... We're going to keep things really simple. And, I was reading that the director was a big fan. He hadn't worked on the previous games necessarily, but he was a huge fan of Castlevania 1. So this is sort of like an unofficial remake. And it's like, this is like Evil Dead 2, where it's half a sequel, half a remake. It kind of just doesn't make any sense. But, you know, things are really simple, but it's just all about the fact that everything is, like, so big and lush and sounds amazing.
Yeah.
And when you played this at the time, you forgot about the fact that, you know, you didn't have three characters like in Castlevania 3 or... all these other sort of bells and whistles or any of the adventure mode stuff of Castlevania 2, you were just looking at this thing thinking like, oh my god, what is going on? This doesn't make any sense. The first time I played this was well before I got a Super NES. My mom rented one for my birthday because we didn't have enough money to get one. So we had invited some friends over, got a Super NES with a whole bunch of games.
Mm-hmm.
I just pick up a knife. Idiot!
Daggers,
who does that?
Dagger's fine.
Actually, it's good for this level. We don't need to kill the boss, right?
Yeah. But you definitely want to get a Banshee Boomerang and hold on to the Banshee Boomerang.
Is that the official name? Is it the Banshee Boomerang?
It is the Banshee Boomerang.
I never knew that there were actual names to this thing. Yeah. Like, look at that. I know. Swinging animation, just totally bananas.
The swinging mechanic in this is really great.
Yeah, I feel like it's something that could have been wasted, like on most games that sort of have these new features at launch just to sort of look cool. But there is actually, especially in like level 3, 2 or something, or around there, there's pretty heavy use of it. It's pretty neat.
Yeah.
And those backgrounds are so weird.
Yeah, that canyon is just like really low res, but really interesting. But the colors are strong, which is what makes it all work, I think.
Oh, I love how this game actually has a ton of slowdown. Like, the first game you get for your Super NES, and you're like, come on, dude, you can't even keep up? If this was today, the internet would explode. There'd be 1,000 Reddit threads about how slow, like, you know, the frame rate reviews for this.
Yeah.
You'd never hear the end of it. You're like, Castlevania 4 only runs at 12 FPS for half the time. Unacceptable. I've started my hunger strike.
Oh, man. Shout-outs to Graph Metal, who is basically just echoing everything. So you mentioned October 31st, 1991.
This came out on Halloween?
The Super Famicom version.
I didn't know that. That's amazing.
That is, that's really cool. And then the North American Super Nintendo release was December.
The same year.
Of the same year, yeah.
Right.
But I mean, like, yeah, that perfect Halloween launch date, of course. Like, every Castlevania game should launch on Halloween.
That's so great. I didn't know. They're like crazy... like crazy strats for skipping all those horse heads and stuff, aren't there?
Oh yeah, there's.
I just don't know what they are.
Crazy strats for doing everything.
I love how fluid this game feels, because especially like I love Castlevania 3 and I've been playing it a lot recently, but the just sort of way that game just has its own brand of physics and just does not care.
Yeah. One of the interesting things about most Castlevania games, especially early NES ones and this one included, don't do it.
I know.
Castlevania games are notorious for their knockback.
Yeah.
When your character takes damage, he just decides to take a jump. Yeah, and exactly. The character's notorious for just finding the closest pit. But the knockback, skeleton horses.
Undead horses in the background? I love that stuff.
Taking advantage of that knockback is one of the most interesting strategies for speedrunning the game.
Right.
Because you can often get an enemy to hit you and knock you to a ledge higher than you would normally be able to reach.
Right.
And that's one of the first things I kind of recognized and realized as a like learning about speedrunning and kind of like intentional damage. It's called a damage boost. But Castlevania is one of the games I think you can take advantage of it the most.
I get so nervous around these. Am I going to drop off?
No, that's one thing they improved in this game over the NES's ones. Is when you're walking towards a downward staircase, you can't just walk past it.
They have like edge detection.
Yeah.
So, sorry. Let's just do this. This music's great. Just love the subtle. I love the subtle window. And also the first Castlevania where you could use items while crouching, because you didn't have to press up and attack.
B. Yeah.
Love it. Like the weird little color shift. What?
Nice. And then, of course, with the orb at the end of every stage, you have to do the coolest pose you can.
That's not bad.
Not bad. That's not bad. That's good. That's an 8 out of 10. That's an 8 out of 10.
Nice.
That's good. That's a good pose. But yes, always jump towards the orb and try to strike the coolest pose you can at the time you grab it. That's always.
So this is one of my favorite things. We're talking about world building. This is... You know, Castlevania always has little in-between level maps, but this is when the Super NES really started to make me, like, just to blow me away, that you would have this, like, animated, huge-looking map that would zoom in and show you. You knew exactly how big the game was, but you didn't really know what any of that stuff meant.
Sure.
But it was so much nicer than just going from, you know, stage 1 to stage 2 and not really, like, that just being an abstract sequence of levels. I love the fact that while I'm playing this, I'm imagining the map and trying to remember the details that I saw before and after to be like, okay, where am I going next? Like, where is this?
Yeah.
And to me, this is what helped make games like this feel larger, like more of a real world.
Like more of a realized world.
Yeah.
For sure, yeah.
And I mean, Castlevania 3 did that really well. I just like doing this. Wow, take that.
Of course, yeah, Castlevania 4 featuring the limp whip.
Yeah, and again, never used again. The greatest feature of all time is never...
I love just the fact that it has 8-way directional whipping.
Yeah.
That's what makes this my favorite Castlevania game.
This is the best. Like,
yeah.
And also, crouch walking. Never done again.
It doesn't get used very much in this game. You're going to need it in a couple levels coming up.
Yeah, you get for secrets and stuff too, right?
Yeah, and even just avoiding some ceiling spikes in a few levels coming up. But yeah, you're right. Like, yeah, this game really does stand alone. It's
the Castlevania game that is like the ignored one in all of canon. Like, all of the Castlevania games that got made after eventually started to feel the same. Mm-hmm. I mean, especially when Symphony came out, and then, or rather after Rondo, and then take that. And they started to have they started to use the same sprites and sort of the same kind of world.
Sure.
The other reason why I like this one is like this is the most Western feeling Castlevania game, because like the graphics are very literal. They're not cartoon styled. Like the rocks look like rocks. Simon just looks like a giant meat monster with metal plates all over him. Like he totally looks like a heavy metal hero dude. Like very it looks kind of 80s actually.
Sure, yeah.
Whereas of course Castlevania got much more into like the much more stylized character design, especially after Symphony and stuff. Things got like much more flowing and impressive. Yeah. This is one of those weird things where the screen just ends and you don't know where you're going until you realize you just need to walk off. I remember thinking I had to stop and wait for a boss.
Oh wow!
Because it's the first time that happens, and it doesn't always happen. Usually, there's a doorway or something that looks like an exit.
That's true that it doesn't. It is pretty inconsistent. Exactly. Quick shout outs to Reg and Kay, talking about the staircases from Castlevania 1-3.
Yeah.
Just like walking unintentionally, trying to mount a staircase and walking over an edge is a very common death in early Castlevania games for sure.
Or trying to get near an enemy or avoid something, like trying to duck a projectile from an enemy and realizing all you're doing is going down the stairs.
Yeah.
That happened to me 2 days ago in Castlevania 3.
And Graph Metal's pointing out to not forget that you can moonwalk up and down stairs.
That's right. I actually don't know if I'm very good at that. Let's see. I just love... Yeah, these early SNES games definitely had their own feel. Like, they didn't feel like they came from any one place. You know what I mean?
That's true, yeah.
Like, you could have told me this was made in Wisconsin, I would have believed you. I don't know why they were specifically, but... It doesn't feel like the way, like, a Japanese-style game would feel today. You'd sort of be able to tell the art style, likely, a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. What do you think... What caused that? What was the reasoning for that?
I think maybe the folks who made this were fans of slightly different things. Because this was a different director on Castlevania, this was not, again, not like Iga, not like some of the folks who would come later and sort of had very specific, like, very heavy gothic overtones. Again, this is a bit more like heavy metal fantasy kind of horror. But the other reason is that I think Castlevania 1, 2, 3, because they're so abstract in their visuals... You kind of didn't know what anything was anyway.
So it's kind of like when creating higher resolution characters like in this.
Yeah.
It's just...
You're like, of course this makes sense. Should have got a double shot. Also, like, nude Medusa when I was like 12 years old or whatever blew my mind. It's like, don't let my mom walk in the room. What kind of smut am I playing here on my video game system? Why is there a double shot right there?
There's rule...
What? Oh, you want me to keep the thing?
Well, yeah.
Well, I use it for these guys.
Oh, okay. But you can diagonal whip.
That's true. I'm not as good as you, can I?
No, that's okay.
That's just the way
it goes. All play styles welcome.
I love the... there's like a neat use of transparency.
Yeah, on that water.
Yeah, transparency and animation, so it kind of looks like it's got a rainbow shimmer to it, which is pretty cool. Neat. Yeah.
Oh man, that was good job.
Barely made it.
And I always thought this stage was interesting when I first played it, because already in the second level they kind of break tradition and change the status quo a bit with the boss is the halfway point of this level.
Yeah.
Because this level just ends coming up.
Yeah.
You're just gonna walk off screen and you're done. But it showed you that. In the map screen before.
That's right.
The bat representing the boss
was
halfway through the dotted path.
Yeah, this game is magical. It's like, to me, it's like Conan. It's just like this timeless adventure that always looks cool, always sounds great, and always makes sense in terms of being this specific genre of game.
Yeah. this is very much, yeah, my Castlevania. This is every trope that I think of Castlevania always reminds me of this game. And yeah. And
the funny thing is, there's never been another Castlevania game like this.
Exactly. That's ever. Why it stayed my favorite.
It's crazy.
Forever. As great as later Castlevanias are, which is very, this is the most purest Castlevania to me.
I love the background. I find this game is, it always looks really lush, and I remember it feeling just so incredibly epic in terms of the coloring and just how rich and detailed everything was. But when you look at it now, it actually is fairly simple. It's just smartly designed.
Mm-hmm.
Like, those backgrounds aren't that complicated. You know, they're actually pretty repetitive when you think about it, but they just felt like nothing you'd ever seen before because they were just throwing every color you could imagine.
Yeah, how about that? Colors. colors are great. Colors are important.
Look at this.
But yeah, especially off in the distance, just the use of greens.
Okay, go down here. Yeah, I want that dude. Oh, I forgot that guy was there. I'm no Jason Cannon. I'm going to make mistakes here.
No deal. All good, man.
And I love these, like, I wonder what these were about. Like, it's just these massively rich bonus rooms. They're all over Castlevania IV. Like in the, I forget what stage it is, but the chest area where the hidden rooms where you just find tons and tons of stuff and it's sort of
there
treasure.
There is a secret, coming up that we're going to find out once we get into Dracula's Castle.
Right.
Which is one that Graph Metal showed me. Reasonably recently, I'd say within the last couple of years, a year or two ago, he showed me that this secret. And we never knew it was there for 20, 22 years.
Yeah.
Despite the fact that I played through this game several times a year. Nice.
I think the water, I'm not sure, but the water drops in this level might be blood in the Japanese version.
Oh, really?
I'm not sure.
That
I could be wrong about that.
I
like how it's just like, is that a secret?
No.
That seems weird.
A variation, but it's interesting that it actually
like
has a
dip.
Like a collision variation as well, like the little dip.
Oh, I totally forgot about all that stuff.
Oh, yeah. Shoutouts to Art by Gavin. Hey,
love
man.
Gavin.
Those monsters were always a favorite. Which one? Are you talking about these rock guys?
The mud monsters? The mudmen?
The mudmen? The dividing, multiplying mudmen?
It's weird. They also put you in, like, usually in Castlevania, like, 3. This is my favorite music. Maybe my favorite game music of all time.
Really?
Yeah.
Piano.
This. So weird. The next stage is my least favorite Castlevania music of all time, so it's funny that they are together.
Really?
And it bums me so much that this is used in exactly this stage.
Yeah,
you never
this
hear it again.
Scream.
And there is no other music like this in any other Castlevania series, or other game in the series. This is where we get a little bit more tricky platforming.
Oh, Gavin was referring to the flying gremlins. In the water, going down the river.
Those things are
those,
pretty cool.
Like flying green goblins. And yeah, they are really cool.
So I just learned something the other day while playing this. Notice, okay, look where I am now. Notice that I'm in front of the waterfalls.
Yep.
Just watching a little bit. This is a little visual trick in the background I had never noticed until just this week. So I'm going to get rid of these. I also love how they just give you, like, just not even difficult. If you. It's okay, cool. We're still in front of the waterfall. Still in front of the waterfall. Just wait.
Okay.
We're getting there. Right up here. Never noticed this. This platform is meant to show you going into the background.
Oh, that's
because
why
watch, now I'm behind the waterfall.
Yeah.
And it's just a little vertical trick. I had never noticed that before.
Sure. That's really smart way of kind of setting that up.
So they just sort of cheat depth, and here you go, you come out of it
you
again.
You come back. I never played that close attention to it. That's really cool.
That sound effect too when you're swinging is just incredible.
Yeah. It's kind of like a door creaking.
Yeah.
But it's so perfect. There's a lot of sound effects. I guess especially from like the Super Nintendo era for me, which is one of my favorite for sound, period. There's a lot of really good sound effects on Super Nintendo, in my opinion. But a lot of them I can never describe.
Sure.
I'm always just like, oh yeah, it's the sound effect that this thing makes in this game.
Right.
But like, what does it sound like? Well, it sounds like the thing in that game.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound like anything else. I can't describe it.
Yeah, it's the really weird use of things that the Ken Kutaragi sound chip, man.
Yeah. The Super Nintendo sound chip is very... there's definitely some people who could speak better to it than I could. Just like with me in music, same kind of thing. I can't explain why I like music. I just know I like some of it.
Oh. Every time. Yeah, every time I make that jump, it's just by the one toe pixel. So this music, man, do I hate this, like, freestyling jazz. This drives me up the wall. I have the soundtrack, because when I went to Japan the first time, I got the Japanese version of Symphony of the Night.
Watch out, crumbly blocks. Nope. Oh, there's that knockback.
Yeah.
That's that knockback. Love that knockback.
And it has a really great soundtrack that spans every single game in the series up to that point.
Oh, nice. Nice.
But every time this track comes on, I just skip it. Cause just like the wee doo 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 doo. Like just someone's just drunk as crap. Going, I'm a jazz guy. And they're just like freaking out. You're like, man, you gotta go home, man. Bar's closed. You can't just take over the piano like that.
Oh, but it speaks to how eclectic kind of the soundtrack is, which is what I like about it.
And they've never done that in another Castlevania game as well. Like, this soundtrack is specific to this. I love those effects. Also, they made different waterfalls. I like these waterfalls better, but they...
You're right, that's not just a reuse of the other ones, yeah.
I find these, these Bone Dragon dudes are placed really oddly in this game. Like, sometimes they're placed, it looks like just... Oh, that was stupid.
Yeah, like he was very clearly mounted to the top of that staircase.
Right.
You understand that, but yeah.
But they're often placed in sort of playful places that don't make any sense. Like, just to kind of mess with you. Oh, I hate these guys. Gotta keep moving.
Yep.
Well, look, you can control your dude in midair. Like, I thought this was Castlevania.
Yeah, this really plays against all Castlevania tropes for the most part.
And it was, this was like the, when you'd been playing, you know, the previous ones for so long.
Nice.
And then you finally got to this and you're like, it's like a whole new world because I can control things.
I'm a big fan.
That always bothered me. Nothing happens there. Is there can you duck? They don't have any of those ducking secrets in this game, do they?
No.
Like the treasure hunts?
No, I think. That's a lesson.
Probably just Castlevania.
Yeah.
It's
a crucifix.
I know.
You can do it.
No, I've never done that before. I've never screwed that up so bad.
But yeah, because I'm a big fan of air control. Air control's a must.
Yeah, man, they're like my favorite prog rock band. Sorry, man, can't risk it.
Yep, you're good.
This guy, I like, they're just putting him here so you can do this.
Yeah.
They're like, hey, don't forget you can whip up. But then there's another one up here that... like that guy.
That's true, because he's not really in your way.
You can't... He's just sort of... I feel like they just did it because it looked good. Like, they sort of aesthetically liked that he was there and how weird it was.
Sure.
Because, I mean, technically, if I was better at this game, I could just jump past him. But I'm not. And see, I just lost all those hearts. They fell into the abyss.
Hey, shoutouts to Kevin Larrabee for joining us.
Hey, Kevin.
On the stream.
How's it going, man?
He says he still needs to do an episode of Back in My Play on this game.
So good.
Which would be a great episode, regardless of who you speak to. Like so many people I know just have fond memories and can speak so much about this game. But people love, in just general, to talk about Castlevania.
Yeah. And this... God, this game is just incredible. What a weird jump spot. Look at this. Now they're just messing with you.
Yeah. Well, they were really just kind of wanting to set up this boss
area. Oh, yeah. I'm terrible at this.
You got this.
Oh, it's been a long time since I played this boss.
Mega Drive BP says, easy listening with Merman in the morning.
Oh, boy.
Gavin's asking about, have there been ancient Greek-themed areas in other Castlevania games?
Yes. Only one other one. Castlevania Bloodlines for the Mega Drive Genesis. The only other one that it has Athens. That's it. I don't think unless there's been just sort of specific stylings. Sorry, man, I'm playing it safe because I'm getting scared.
That's okay. Take out the bottom one, because it's the one that shoots the three-way. Yeah, just keep whipping.
Oh, some Ranger Brigade. Oh, buddy.
Okay. Yeah, the one that has the short-range purple smoke can't do anything to you.
Oh, man.
It's okay. And there you go. Hopefully, he's the one you don't want. Nice.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, see? You're fine. There you go.
Oh.
See?
Woo!
Okay, grab that orb. Nice!
Same pose.
Another 8. It's another 8 out of 10. The best pose possible, I think Graph Metal may need to remind me.
What is it like, throwing your whip up?
It's whipping diagonal down.
Oh,
as you grab fully extended.
I see.
That's my favorite. It's
pure metal. Man, we're already here already. Like, look at this.
Lots of love for Bloodlines in the chat.
Yeah, Bloodlines is just so bizarre. Such a weird game. That was when Konami was like, hey, we figured out how the Genesis works. Here's a series of incredible games.
Yeah, that and Hardcore.
Yeah.
Contra Hardcore, yeah, both.
And was it Rocket Knight, not far before that?
I want to say after. I think Rocket Knight came out after
was
both
it?
Games. I think so. Rocket Knight was pretty late, because even on the Super NES version, Rocket Knight, I want to say, is 93-ish.
Well, Bloodlines is definitely at least 94.
Oh, yeah, no, you're right. Bloodlines was really late for the Sega Genesis.
Because I just remember what a big deal it was at the time.
Excellent. Lots of love for Bloodlines, and Graph Metal is saying, correct, full points for diagonal down whip pose.
My favorite thing about Simon in this game, there's no idle animation on him, but he always just does this, he's just flexing, what a bro this guy is. And look how big his legs are. They're humongous. I love it.
Yeah, they are more than half his height.
Oh, crap, what am I doing? Look how manly this dude is. He doesn't skip leg day. Simon Belmont doesn't skip leg day.
Well, he's got a jump. He's got that good jump.
Castlevania, please. Oh!
Oh.
I'm going to blame that on input lag. I think Kevin Larrabee can help us speak to this. The importance of playing on original hardware to avoid
that's
all
true.
Input lag.
We are playing on the Wii U Virtual Console, which is mostly because it's just easier to record from. Because of the HDMI.
Twice in a row? Okay, come on now. I gotta hand in my badge. I might have to switch the controller, Canem, and I'll just talk about Castlevania.
We can take turns.
Take that.
Castlevania, for me, speaking to old classic games, for me, other than something like Mega Man, is a game that's really about its bosses.
Yeah.
It's lots of games had bosses, but in a lot of games it would just be kind of unnamed. Even a game like Ninja Gaiden, the bosses are kind of just, they don't have that much
should
personality.
I go down there? I forget.
No, don't do it.
Forget. Yeah.
I would almost compare Castlevania bosses to modern, Dark Souls bosses. The bosses are all big deals.
And the weird thing is they all... I mean, especially sort of in these early, the first four, they were all based on horror tropes.
Yes.
Somebody watched a bunch of Hammer movies and was like, cool, these things are awesome. Let's just throw them all in. And then
oh.
I got this. is it Lixie Whip? Horixiel?
Yeah.
Is there a double shot here? No.
No. But just...
I'm not good at the stress
just
this
wear,
guy.
Just keep whipping him. Stand in place, whip. You'll wear him down before he wears you down.
Life, dude. That's what you just hope.
There you go.
And I love it. Just hey, actually, it was the designer of the game who was the boss programmer for this game as well. So I bet you he was like, I think we can fit more transparency in this game. Or Nintendo was like, cool, not enough. I don't see enough effects in this. Can you just make this boss transparent? But it doesn't do anything. Just do it. Make him transparent.
Sure. Well, speaking of tech demos,
here we go.
This is the showcase tech demo room. For the game.
Just, and you don't do anything other than wait.
Yeah. It's just let Mode 7 do its thing.
So
that's
great.
What this room is, let Mode 7 play the game for
mind
you.
Mind-blowing. So, the one thing is that, the Castlevania games, oh boy. Oh, there is knockback when you're on there. Sorry, I thought there wasn't when you were hanging.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so definitely jump off.
Faster.
And then just, prepare to deal with the Medusa head onslaught from the platform. Kevin Larrabee's asking, are you guys more a fan of the original style games or the Symphony of the Night-like games, so the Metroidvania-ish? And, you know, Castlevania is half of Metroidvania.
Right.
Like, well, I mean...
What am I doing?
Symphony of the Night really defined...
What am I doing?
Metroidvania as a genre.
It's Last Life, dude. I can't cheese out on this.
You got this.
You can tell I write narrative games.
But but for me, like we both mentioned, this is our favorite game in the series, and this is the one that's most indicatively Castlevania to me.
Yeah.
So, I guess what I'm trying to get at is I think the Metroidvania games from Symphony of the Night onwards are objectively better games.
Are they?
Because they really cemented a genre. They really defined themselves. But this is just more... It's more Castlevania to me, is the best I got. So I do prefer this style of Castlevania game.
This is
to
just,
the Metroidvanias.
Yeah, like I said, the fact that this is such a horror sort of influence, you know, like it's like a classic horror kind of franchise,
mm-hmm.
In the sort of tropes that it uses. But the fact that it's just so heavy metal... is great. Like, Castlevania IV is just balls-to-the-wall 80s metal. Symphony of the Night is like Dream Theater. So it's a different style of metal. So it's a little
okay.
bit more fanciful.
Sure.
A bit more intricate. But this is just like, oh my god! Like, just classic 80s thrash metal. Also, this is insane.
Yeah.
Oh, man. No.
This is some more of that tech demo is.
Like, again, if this was released today, there'd be not one... but 5 Digital Foundry articles about how this game just can't keep up with its insane scrolling levels. Because look at this, it's not even a good idea to make a game like this. Back then, we didn't care. Our minds were being, like, just melted out of our skulls.
Yeah, this was really... But it just speaks to the importance of, like, coming back again. Like, the Super Nintendo's launch lineup is crazy.
Yeah.
And, like, all quality software that was also doing the job of showing, like, what's impressive about the new hardware.
Yeah. Like, one thing, like, pointless. Absolutely pointless level. It's the most memorable part of the game. You love it.
Yeah.
This level's super hard. I always mess this up a lot.
No problem.
If I have to continue, do I get to continue from here?
We're gonna find out. If it happens, we will see.
Oh, man. Wait, am I supposed to go that way, or am
I
supposed to go up?
You're supposed to go up.
Man, why is this so hard? Why is it so hard, Jason Cannon?
Jump much later than you think you have to. You have a few pixels.
There we go. All right, this is Coronaut, another one of those great, terrible pun names, backwards pun names. I feel like this game, like, you know, you can tell when a game's been made with love, but you can also tell when people maybe had fun making a game, and that's what I get out of this.
Yeah, yeah.
Castlevania 3 is so, like, so crazy complex. I feel like... Should I be going up or right?
Go up, because this part wraps around vertically, so you're going to come back to there and then head
Wait,
to the right.
Wait, it does?
Yeah.
I've never known that.
Yeah, it'll infinitely wrap forever,
never
and you eventually want to make yourself to that same room,
never
but it's easier
that.
To go up and wrap.
I feel like Castlevania 3 is like this: the NES doing a bunch of things it has no business doing, and just...
Sure.
It's a technical feat, you know, so many things, all the characters, the switching, just the visual detail, all that kind of stuff. But with this, it just feels like... Every stage is awesome. This is like the perfect album. Somebody made the perfect 10-song album with Castlevania 4, and every song is good. And it feels like a previous... Wait, no, not this one.
Yep, keep rapping. I'm just going to catch up on chat. Mega Drive is saying that, like when you're talking about that last warping room, you're showing off some of that Mode 7, and this with moving platforms really makes the castle feel alive. And makes the castle a character.
Yeah, that's
very
true.
Much, and is very much, and that's, I mean,
that happens later on too with the books and all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Like I think with Castlevania, Dracula's castle, which
what was that? Why am I bad at games? You are kidding me.
Do you want to switch out?
Let's do a switch.
Okay, we'll switch. I'll let you get caught up on chat. There's some interesting stuff in chat.
Oh my gosh.
And,
what have
here,
we done?
I'll drive for a bit.
What have we done? Okay.
Yes, Kevin Larrabee is saying some good stuff.
Nice. Yes, Kevin Laird, we will absolutely be guests on your Super Castlevania 4 episode.
Oh.
As you can tell, we can talk about this forever.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for coming out, Kevin.
There's so much more to say. Like, there's an unlimited amount of material to talk about. Okay, I'm going to moonwalk up some stairs.
So, for people who are in the chat, which one is your favorite? And why?
Yeah. See? Some moonwalking.
So, now we're going to see how real... a real superstar plays this game. See, I'm all about feelings, remember? So as I'm playing this game, I'm like just trying to figure out what these poor skeleton bastards are going through as you whip them into oblivion, and like what their families must be going through. It's like they're skeleton guards. They're on just on shift. It's like you're killing a mall cop. You know, he's just like Dracula's mall cop. He's like, oh man, I can't wait to go home and see my kids.
Oh my god.
We're gonna go on vacation. I'm finally gonna retire and get that boat I've always wanted. Here comes Simon Belmont. The colors in this game are pretty bananas, too. And they actually, kind of like Super Metroid, they don't, a lot of the backgrounds are actually not as intricate as you might expect. Like, they're very specific tile sets. Like,
mm-hmm.
You can see the tile sets. And I remember reading, like, in GamePro, they sort of chided Super Metroid for that. Dude, don't keep it cool, man. Don't jump.
I'm good.
But you kind of just don't feel it with this.
Sure.
I guess because there was just so much detail. He's got vampire teeth, man.
I never noticed that!
Yeah, man.
That's a vampire skull!
He's on brand.
That makes perfect sense.
On brand.
Wow! I'm so glad you game over so you can teach me that lesson.
I think the design of this level is really interesting because I think all the heavy shading of things is to help... Hope with the mode 7. I don't know what it is, but this is the only time they ever do this heavy shadowing on anything.
Yeah, that's true. You're right.
I have a feeling it has something to do with like playing it on old CRT, like through like a crappy
episode. Oh, sure.
Okay. But also, when you're here, this kind of doesn't make any sense. Like, you're not really sure what to do. And I remember being a kid thinking that there was no way you're just going to sit here and whip like a million Medusa heads. It'd be cool. But then eventually they do let up. Nice. Megatribe BP says, alone with Boo, a romantic Castlevania adventure.
That would be fantastic.
Thanks for calling out my next game, dude. Way to give it up. Graph Metal says, other than Castlevania 4, Castlevania 3, and Order of Ecclesia. I don't think I played Order of Ecclesia. I must have tried it, but I haven't played it through. Castlevania 3 is hard, man. That game
Castlevania 3 is too hard.
It's too hard. Purposefully, just like...
Yeah.
Mega Drive BP says his favorites are between this, Bloodlines, and Dawn of Sorrow. That's a really interesting spread. You both have very interesting spreads of Castlevania games.
I find people typically will have their favorite NES one and their favorite Metroidvania.
One old school and one Metroidvania?
Yeah. Like, I haven't seen too many people pick, like... Circle of the Moon and Harmony of Dissonance.
Yeah, that's true. So if you... if Konami wasn't just a smoldering ruin of hopelessness, and suddenly you had this, you had Super Castlevania V, how excited would you be?
The most. I can't think of... There's very few things I'd be more excited for.
Considering there were things like, you know, new Contra and stuff like that on the DS...
Sure.
I'm shocked that we have never got an old school Castlevania game, especially on systems like the DS.
The closest we got was Castlevania Adventure Rebirth on the Wii.
I never played that.
Which was like a remake of... It was just like when they did Contra Rebirth.
I never played that, that's right.
Contra Rebirth is...
Was that a download-only game, or can you buy that?
It was a download-only game.
I'm
going to
get
that.
Just on
the Wii.
I'm going to get that. I did not know.
And they also did Gradius Rebirth. Yeah, they did a whole Rebirth
That's
series
right.
on the Wii.
That's totally right. I never played that for whatever reason.
And they're all pretty good.
So, you know, it's weird. Like, this level visually is pretty simple compared to a lot of the other ones. And I wonder if that has to do with the wrapping. Because what they're doing means, like, the tile sets are really simple in the background.
Yeah.
I wonder if it's because of whatever they're doing with the wrapping. I don't even know how to program this.
Oh, madness. Old school game programming is
magic.
It is truly magic.
Graph Metal says Contra Rebirth is way better.
Way better than?
Than Castlevania Rebirth, I guess.
Okay. I want to say Contra Rebirth was one of the closest things to Contra 3 we've gotten in a long time.
And they did make Contra 3, right? What was the one? Or Contra 4?
Contra 4 is DS. Yeah. But Contra 4 is like the Mega Man 9 of Contra.
It's funny. So we're already in stage 4-4, and now we're getting the Castlevania 3 spikes.
Yeah.
That's interesting. They sort of just hold some of this stuff up. And this is great. They were like, you know, it'd be fun, like, just make you just pee your pants in terror. So these, like, some of these areas, you're starting to get some classic Castlevania stuff.
Yeah, these are real.
Those tiles are amazing, like with the mounted knight and stuff. But this is one of the, like, to me, you can tell this feels like a bit of a reboot because it doesn't look like Castlevania at all until you get to the later stages.
Yeah.
So it's almost like a reboot movie where, you know, you don't see the hero in their original outfit until the third act. Oh, it's good old Coronaut. I love how he just violently scales every time you hit him. And I'm assuming this is such a visually simple fight because they're spending all the time to scale him.
Yeah.
And it was just easier than making the game run at 5 frames a second. Just like,
and some of that mode 7.
Make him like, he's so weird looking.
Yeah.
Do it.
Oh, there it is.
Oh, nicely
it.
Done.
That's 10 out of that. That's.
You're there better you than me, Jason Cannon. It's been captured on video. I'll never live it down.
No deal.
So what are we on now, stage
5? So stage 5. So now this is the final approach to Dracula's Castle, to Castlevania.
And this is where we get... This is where it starts to look a little bit more familiar. I always prefer the beginning of this game to the end. Well, this is still pretty fun.
Oh, yeah? There. Oh.
Yeah, because I like the fact that it just looks so different. I mean, granted, like, being in the castle, like, the final approach to Dracula and that whole thing is one of my favorites. But, like, all the cool foreground details... like
Yeah, this is a big step up. Like, there's a lot happening... on the screen right now. This is really, and the music is really kind of atmospheric and kind of.
Yeah, this isn't drunk freestyle jazz. This is some legit stuff.
Oh, that's perfect.
That's so true, man.
I admit that I think same as well. Like when I used to play this a lot when I was younger, I did prefer the first part of the game.
I think it's front loaded with its best ideas for the most part.
But. The best music and the best level design comes much later. And
okay.
We'll definitely...
Well, we can argue with that when we get there. If we get there.
Well, we'll get there.
Well, now that you're on the controls, we're definitely going to get there. If it was me, we'd be talking about feelings in stage 1-2. So yeah, they showed you on the map that you're going through the forest. Oh, classic Castlevania thing. They always give you the invincibility item at the least... or the most pointless time to use it, when you never need it.
Yep.
I don't know what that is.
And screen clearing.
Yeah.
And there aren't even strategies to try to optimize it. It's never at a good time.
Yeah. It's just, they're like, I don't know, throw something in a candle? Let's do this. It's pointless. But it always looks cool, so whatever. And now we're, like, what, in the undergrowth of some cavern? Like, I like to think of this as, like, we're beneath the castle now. This is the part that's neglected. Maybe those are, like, those... sort of vertical parts are, that's like Dracula's sewage system. Those are all where all his toilets flush to. You know, we're just getting up there. That always reminded me of Sypha.
Definitely. That's definitely a shout out to Sypha. Okay. I think so.
And that's like, what a great entrance.
Yeah, and we brilliant. So now, and then now we get the new map screen.
I know, and this is the part that's so cool because you're like, wait, what? There's a whole
other map? Yeah.
This is like the Wily's Castle of Castlevania.
This is just begun. And then this is straight up presentation from the original Castlevania.
Yeah.
This is the entrance hall from Castlevania.
Yeah. Same. And actually, this looks more like I think like the MSX Haunted Castle or whatever. Oh no, Haunted Castle was the arcade game. But this looks like the MSX kind of stuff. The textures and stuff sort of just remind me of that.
Do you remember I'm going to hold off on it, but do you remember the name of the boss of this?
Oh, yes. We'll mention it when we get there. Okay. I do.
Okay, good.
Because I remember reading the manual and being, what?
Yeah, I love it.
Because
I
think
it, so much.
It was the, I don't think it was like Treehouse at the time, but it was the North American localization team that just kind of redid all that stuff, right?
Yep.
And that's why this is like one of the most Western Castlevanias, because they got rid of all the sort of things that would become Castlevania tropes and the names of, I don't know what any of the names of the enemies are in Castlevania, but I do remember the ones in here.
Yeah.
Because they're just weird.
There's always been a lot of interesting naming stuff in, to me, this is one of the most memorable parts of the game.
And this was, again, it was basically like the director, and again, I forget his name, was basically trying to show the director of Castlevania 3 that he was better than him. Because he's like, oh, yeah, those cool swinging pendulums in Castlevania 3. Like, that's fun. Look at this.
It's a whole chandelier.
It's a giant, pointlessly large chandelier. And this eventually became something they did in all the, like a lot of other Castlevanias. They'd have giant swinging chandeliers. Or maybe not giant ones. But, and I love how the flames of the candles are all accurate. They switch from side to side as they move.
Yeah. They're straight and then they... Yeah. And just when it's at the end of its momentum, yeah, you see that they're straight up.
That's amazing. And then they're like, oh yeah, we have these swinging things. We should do those again. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Man, level design was so cool back then. Like, just make a cool thing. You can ride that for 50 minutes. Easy.
Okay. It's not hard, but it's such a tense part.
Oh, yeah.
They build it up nicely. The glowing red, the music changes for just that screen.
Yeah. This is where things kind of get real, I remember. I remember finding this particularly brutal. And there's a floor exit, right? Is that under that?
Oh, man.
It's under one of the chandeliers.
Graph Metal's going to be so mad at me, but I forget. I think it's in the next section.
It's here.
He's going to get so mad in the chat. I'm sorry, Graph.
Yeah, it's in... And I love pointless floaty shiny thing.
Yeah.
Like, what is that? I guess like a poltergeist or something? Oh.
You can kill it. That's what's important. That's all that's important.
That's what Simon Belmont thinks. Do you think Simon Belmont's kind of like Doom in the new Doom? Like Doom guy? He's just like a...
Oh, man.
Angry, mindless killing machine? Because they always talk about, you know, it's always the Belmont family. Like, imagine what the Belmont family Thanksgiving dinner's like. Like, it's just a bunch of just roided up psychopaths. And they've all been through so much shit that they just... no one can look each other in the eye anymore. Because they're just remembering all the terrible horrors they've been through. I think it's really good.
As do I.
I think this is one of those secrets...
Is the chat giving us any hints yet?
This section.
Okay.
So, yeah, we are here. I thought it was under a chandelier.
I thought it was under a chandelier, too.
I remember this is one of those tricks I think I read in EGM or something. Because I had no idea. Or maybe it was a Nintendo Power. Probably Nintendo Power.
Oh, I missed it. I know I missed it. I'm sorry. I totally messed up.
Oh. Oh, we passed it.
Sorry, Graf.
Toward the beginning of the room. You're going back? Leave no secret behind?
I'm going to try.
Does it actually let you go all the way back in this? Or
yeah.
Does it block you up at some point?
Up until there's a transition. Pretty sure it was back here. I'm going to do it.
Look at this, how hardcore you are, man.
Well, I'm just embarrassed that I'm totally blanking.
Just imagine what Simon Belmont's going through at this moment. He's like, oh, God, finally routed this area. And then he's thinking, oh, no. He's like, I left my car keys at home. I got to go back and get them. Under the second chandelier.
Which was...
I forget because we destroyed them all.
I know.
I think we passed it. I think Graph Metal said we passed it. Is that what you have to do? Hold it? You can't just whip it?
No, you hold it. I want to say it's right here because it's this big, large chunk.
I'm waiting to see if the chat's helping us out.
I'm so sorry.
Come on, Simon Belmont. Aren't the chandeliers always... No, I think you're right there.
I'm going to leave it for now. I'm just being disgraceful.
It's okay. We'll find the treasure room.
Yeah. I feel really bad. I should have not missed that, but...
Hey, man, for the first
been a
five,
while.
5 years this game came out. Thinner floor, he said, not one of the chunks.
Oh, okay.
So it wasn't... It was under an arch.
Yeah, no, that was my fault for missing it completely. Although now, I feel really bad. Okay, good. We're just going to move on.
Those dudes have no animation. The dance, like
yeah,
the ghosts and the suits?
Really economical.
Oh, buddy.
It's okay.
Don't pull a me. You're better than me.
I've definitely learned that it's really hard to play on stream.
Dude, you're the Harvey Dent to my Batman. You're the hero we need and deserve.
Thank you. That's okay. I'm definitely going to take a hit up here because... Is Graph Metal really disappointed?
He says we gave up. We were like 2 tiles away.
Oh,
we just missed
I'm
it.
Sorry.
It's okay, man.
I hate this.
Do they always trigger when you
yeah.
walk past them?
And they're not vulnerable until they activate.
Right.
And they don't activate until you walk past them. Which is such a bad trick. It's such a mean trick.
Well, this is when the game starts getting really weird, right? Because once you get into the library and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember this is where I feel like the game is less interesting. Well, this stuff I like, but because it starts to feel a lot more cartoonish then.
Okay.
You know, like to
maybe
me,
it gets over the top.
Yeah, it reminds you of some levels of like a Splatterhouse.
Oh, sure.
You know, just sort of weird paranormal kind of stuff. What are that heads in the bottom? Like, what are those things in the bottom?
I think they're just like
statues,
catacomb graves. Alcoves with little bodies, like yeah, the drastic scene change right here is always I always found quite jarring.
But it does you just sort of feel like you're moving up a bit, and I like how once you start to see the windows, you can see there's a storm brewing outside. Like
yeah,
nice, nicely done. But compared to like the lush. Sort of areas of the first few levels.
Yeah, this is kind of
more plain. But I mean, hey, you know.
I wonder if people called this next gen Grays and Browns.
Next gen. No way, man. We were just like our minds were exploding.
Yeah, no, that's true. It does. It like Dracula's Castle starts off a bit like this, a bit of a lull. But yeah, I really want to power through the next couple stages because then it really blows up.
Yeah.
At
well,
a point.
The weird thing is like the main map before you get here sort of shows you more of the verticality and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But once you get into the castle, the way it shows it is much more simple and iconic. So you don't actually get a sense of where you're going. Like it basically looks like an old game map. It says you're going to go through an area and there's a boss at the end.
That's true. It doesn't give you an indication of anything.
But they don't sort of show you that you're going through these particular halls or... What's that?
You can crouch. As long as you don't get grabbed by the hands, the skeleton won't activate.
What?
So you can crouch walk under the hands. I should have been doing it before.
I've never known that before. Yeah. Mad strats. Mad strats McGarnacle here. Working his magic.
Oh, man. It's okay. We're almost done with this stage with the ballroom.
Right. I would like to think this is like a nod to Castlevania 2 when you fight Dracula.
Oh, sure.
Because that was always the way he spun around.
Yep. And then you're fighting buffet tables.
Yeah. Yeah, this is what...
Like, this is my best. It's ballroom dancers.
Buffet tables.
Buffet tables, chandeliers.
It's not a lot of animation going on there. The tables are so weird. This is like Ghostbusters now. You're just, like, knocking over everything. Yeah, but you're like, okay, I guess this is Dracula's dining hall. Cool. It's really big. It's like Bruce Wayne's in 1989 Batman. Take that. Long ago, Simon Belmont was working in the catering business, and he just was like, never again. That's the first one-up you found.
Yeah.
I also find it weird that it just says one-up, considering how thematic everything else is.
Exactly, yeah. There's no icon with it. It's not like, yeah. Okay, so what's this boss?
This is Paula Abdul and Fred Ascare.
Yes, it is. also, we get new boss music starting from here on out.
Oh, yeah, and that is just because it's in Dracula's Castle, is that right?
Yep.
I love the screen, just like everything is super powerful.
Yeah, Fred Ascare and Paula Abdul, yeah. That's my favorite boss in the game entirely because thanks, localization team.
And those statues don't look like appear anywhere else. And here we go. Yeah, so this is the part where
you're
like.
Yeah, you're right. This is like, it lets you know, like, oh, I'm going to go down a bit, I'm going to go around.
Oh, I guess I guess it does show you some verticality. I'm wrong. But then you get to see the tower in the back, like classic Castlevania tower.
Yeah, but you don't get a sense of what you're coming up to. Like before, it was like, oh, we're going into a cave.
Yeah.
We're going downstream. We're going into a forest.
Do you think maybe they didn't know?
Interesting.
Maybe when they were developing, they're like, we don't know. Like, we just have to get, we're just going to get some general level layouts like this. So just hurry up, make the map.
That's interesting.
Maybe those parts were developed sort of in conjunction, not one after the other.
That's a really good point. I'd be curious to take a look. Oh, man, I forgot those guys stab up. I'd be curious to check some preview footage and magazine covers, see what levels they were showing off before release. And if they're all, like, if it's the library and it's the last level, then, yeah, you could draw the conclusion that they were working on those first.
Also, the sort of, like...
Anubis statues?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now we're getting crazy. Things are getting a little weird. They don't use these floating... Spectre demons nearly as much.
No, we haven't seen any since actually the first stage, the stables.
And Castlevania 3 is just
It's
like wherever you can put one of those things to make things extra difficult. It's like a drinking game. You just know one's gonna be there. Mega Drive BP says this room is really similar to Disney World's Haunted Mansion. I think he was speaking about the previous room with the buffet tables.
Oh, okay. That's really interesting. That's an interesting parallel.
Art by Gavin says the statues sort of look like Black Panther. I'm like, they do look like his costume. That's legit. Graph Metal says, I can't explain why, but the fact that you can see the ceiling in the background makes this level look really cool. It's true. They never do that before. They actually give like a one-point perspective depth to the level. And you can see the shelves and whatnot. They add in depth. But this is, again, one of those things where this game, like, the art styles are kind of all over the place a little bit.
Sure.
And the one thing I don't know is I think they might have had slightly different teams on things.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
Because some of these levels definitely look different.
Well, like, these platforms, these blocks I'm standing on right now, they have depth to them.
Yeah.
I'm not standing just on top of them, but, like, before...
But the shelves don't. Like, the shelves are in the wrong... They're in a different perspective.
Yeah. That's really interesting. There's a lot you can learn by just paying a little bit more attention.
Well, you're too busy.
More than I have.
You're too busy being great.
No, I'm...
I'm just looking over here. I'm just in your shadow, Canem. Paying attention to all the wonderful things I'll never get to experience because I'm not as good as you.
That's not true.
That's kind of how our friendship goes.
Oh, man. No deal. No deal, Ben.
If this was Castlevania 3, you would never have got a foot on any stair. You'd just be dead all the time. Because everything, you just would roll off all of them.
Oh, yeah. This part, you have to make sure not to fall too far.
Yeah, and I don't remember. I don't remember this level layout much, so I can't do, like, the speed run kind of moves.
Okay, yeah. You don't want to, this is it. You don't want to drop down there to the right.
Right.
Take that step. Okay. I'm going to hold on to my Banshee boomerang.
Now you're
writing some
books.
Some,
like, just
really.
Incredibly green books.
Yeah, those are definitely, those are intense. Those are high contrast. Purple and green books.
Gavin says that you like the fly fishing approach to whipping.
Uh oh. Okay, good.
That's the first time they ever did a diagonal platform in this.
Yeah.
So you're skipping some of these candles.
Yeah.
You know what's in them?
No, most of them are small hearts. I'm just going to avoid. Oh, yeah, I love this part.
Look, several decades before the Harry Potter films, we have, like, the ghost paintings.
Living paintings, yeah.
That statue sort of looked like a weird cat. I couldn't get a...
Wall chicken.
Wall chicken.
I mean, I've just been waiting to talk about wall chicken.
I think we should have a themed dinner next time we play this and make wall chicken.
Make some wall chicken? I'd say wall chicken. Would you say wall chicken is the longest lasting, most enduring, like Castlevania meme slash trope?
It's the thing I think of most when I think of Castlevania. More than vampires and whips is wall chicken.
Is wall chicken.
Yeah.
I think so too.
But to me, it was always turkey. I always thought it was turkey.
It's festive?
No, because it was so big. I was like, oh, okay. Chicken's not that big. That's got to be at least a turkey. Like, as a kid, I was trying to rationalize what this thing was.
This is an interesting reuse of the enemies from the first level who are hanging around the castle battle turrets.
Throw them in
paintings. And now they're in paintings. And this dog has a really cool mechanic where it can destroy candles around the stage that it crosses.
What?
It just destroyed one.
I had never seen that before.
But it doesn't really get leveraged or used ever.
Sure.
And there's a weird fire snake mini boss down there that you can just not fight.
That looks like
It looks like something from R-Type or Gradius.
Salamander or Life Force.
Yeah.
Salamander. Just ridiculous amount of candles for no reason. Man, that old lady trapped in the painting. Looking pretty hurting. This is a fun thing because it's just like a jerk move.
Yeah, exactly. If you don't crouch, you will get pushed up into the spikes and just insta-killed.
But the fact that, like, again, at this point, it's like goofy horror stuff. This is like a kid's movie.
This is like Goosebumps.
Yeah.
This level right now kind of feels like Goosebumps, Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Yeah, and it's like Splatterhouse again.
Splatterhouse.
Just
is
like
good.
silly horror tropes. Here we go. So we were in the dining area, and then we were in the storage area, now we're in like the weapons locker. I like some of that stuff, you're sort of getting a sense. And I like how you see the weapons just before you see the armor case.
Yeah.
Sort of set you up. What's this guy's name? I don't remember. If anyone in the chat knows what this dude's name is. Graph Metal says they're pork chops, according to the translation. Good call.
3 for 3. For cool ass whip pose.
Mix it up, Cam. Come on.
Okay, I'll do a better one next time. Or not a better one, a different one. This next level also has weird music. The weird jungle rhythms. Got the jungle drums, I always say.
Oh yeah, and you just get thrown. That's new.
Yeah, that is kind of cool. But it does show the drop right here.
You get
dropped right down. And now you've got this is my least favorite level.
There's dots on the right lower right hand side of this map. Are those supposed to indicate something? See that?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Is that a secret path?
No.
Is there something...
I actually don't know what that is.
Would that be where the treasure room is, where you eventually get to...
Oh,
no,
maybe.
But the treasure room's only, like, one extra room, isn't it? Yeah, this music is legit. This is really good. And these are the platforms you can actually jump on.
Yes.
These are supposed to be red. Those
this is all supposed to be blood, but instead it's just, like,
slime.
Green acid slime stuff. Yeah.
Sir Gracul was the name
Sir
of that
Gracul.
that knight we just destroyed.
I knew it was a G. I think I call him Sir Gremlin.
This actually might be one of my other favorite attractions.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
This is one of the weirdest ones to me. I don't know if I like, not like or dislike, but this is a weird track. Oh, man. So many spikes in this level.
I know. Too tall. Take it. Take it in the eye. those are weird versions of the usual monster, which is the eye that faces you with the tail.
Yeah, yeah.
But they just made them simple, like left to right enemies.
Yeah.
I wonder why that was. If they just like said, "We don't want to program this anymore."
I don't know. They were they're not that different from the white dragons.
I guess
the things coming out of the wall. It's kind of the same tech, the same style.
Are you even hitting it? Or is it too... Is it not registering damage?
It was probably too close to the edge of the screen.
Yeah, this is my second favorite track in this album. Or in this album. In this game.
Oh,
the first
cool.
one was 3-2, whatever it was.
Oh, sure. My favorite track is coming up, possibly the next level.
Wait, is it Vampire Killer?
No, it's not Vampire Killer.
It's actually my least favorite Castlevania song.
Really?
Yeah. Like, I understand why people like it, but it's just that I found... Once, especially, I think once this came out, to me, this sort of redefined how much more rich and interesting the music could be. So the fact that people like just freak out whenever they hear a remix of Vampire Killer.
Yeah. I hate this level. Okay.
Checkpoints are brutal in this.
Checkpoints are brutal in this level. There's too many spikes. Okay. The next two levels are my two favorite parts of this entire game. And two favorite tracks.
If you have to continue, I'm taking over.
Yep. That sounds fair.
Which is not going to happen. You planned so long, didn't you? You knew I'd just die so fast. Like, just only a matter of time.
No way, you did really well.
You were... Thanks. Thanks, Dad.
Well, come on. I'm not going to invite you on the show and then make fun of you.
Oh. I was prepared for that 100%.
Oh man, no way.
I never noticed that before. Look at the ground. It's like bits of the stairs.
Oh.
Like whatever the stairs are made of.
Yeah. That's an interesting contrast to like the bluish green stones. Oh, I see.
Nice.
Oh, okay.
Good use of the super whip.
And all of these spikes are all insta-kill spikes.
That one, I thought you hit that one before and it wasn't.
No, I got hit by something else.
Oh,
before.
Okay. You're good. Dude. Oh, the turkey.
It's okay. That was rough. I shouldn't have let that happen, but...
That could have been chicken.
I was rushing
baseball.
A bit. This... Most of my playthroughs end right here. I'm done for today.
I have a Wii, like original Wii virtual console save on the stage.
I have nothing and here. I'm still not going to take the pocket watch. I don't care.
Dude, I wish it worked on platforms.
Yeah, me too. No. Ah, crud.
But you just start at the bottom, or the...
No,
it brings you all the way back here?
In fact, I think there may not be a halfway checkpoint in this level.
What are you doing? This is when Konami's like, just take those checkpoints out. Game's, like, you can beat it too quickly.
This is good, but I'm playing the worst I've played this in years.
Mega Drive BP says, Sinking Old Sanctuary is my forever favorite song. Is that what this is? Because I don't know the names of the songs.
No, that's from, I want to say that's from, that's from Bloodlines.
Oh, okay. What level is that? Mega Drive? Because I don't remember.
That'd be the Athens one we were talking about earlier.
Oh, all right then. That makes sense.
It got reused in Dawn of Sorrow, I believe.
Oh,
please
I didn't
know. Please
let me
know, Mega Drive.
Okay. So, Art by Gavin asks, in keeping with exploration games, what type of quote-unquote lure best hooks you most into checking every corner of a level? So, like, what would make you... want to just check for secrets, look for stuff? Is it like, to me it would be the promise of more content, like in like once you realize in Rondo that there are all these branching paths,
sure,
keys that open doors, and like this sort of adventure aspect to it, that makes me want to really pay attention. If it's just, you know, treasure or something, it's less exciting for me. So if it's like new music, new content, that does it for me.
Sure.
What about you?
Anything that affects gameplay, so the most obvious thing is upgrades. And that's
sure
what Metroidvania games are built around.
Right, like you're always going to get...
You're going to get more missiles, you're going to get a stronger gun, or you're going to get... And like Metroidvania games are built entirely around the fact you're collecting things that change the gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
A double jump, the ability to fly, the ability to fit into tight spaces.
Well, that's why they're so hard to design too, right? Because...
Oh, come off it.
You have to plan. The game has to be good at the beginning all the way till when you're powered up 50,000 times at the end. And it all starts
yes.
to make sense.
And it's hard to do that.
That's like doing a narrative game, because you have to have a narrative or different parts of narratives that work with a whole bunch of different contexts and choices.
Mm-hmm.
And they have to make sense. But with Super Metroid, it's the same way. The level has to make sense when you come back to it the 15th time, not
yes.
just the first time. Oh, right. So Mega Drive says that's the one with the flooding water, which is the grease
yep.
one. Yeah. And, yeah. Good. Yeah, so you guys are
yep.
in agreement with this stuff. Yeah, I think I don't remember the first time I beat this. It was a long time after I played. I never owned this game on Super NES. I just rented it a bunch. Did you own it?
Not at first. Rented it a bunch. Because I remember first time I rented it, or second time, I think. Oh. Was literally got to Dracula and then had to return it.
Oh. Wait, because of time?
Yeah, because it was like, it had to be due that day. The rental thing was weird. It was like, it had to be returned on the day of by like 3 p.m.
Okay.
And it was literally like 2:55, and I was at Dracula.
Oh, man.
And then it was literally like turned off in front of me, being like, no, it's now done.
So did you, when you would rent games, because we're both of the age that was kind of how we experienced most games back then.
Yeah.
How many would you say you beat? What percentage of games that you rented?
Oh, very, very small. Because like you only got them for 2 days, 3 days max.
I only know two that I beat. At least that I can remember.
Oh, I'm trying to think.
And they're both the worst games. Like, they're both total easy baby games. So the first one is I beat Mario's Missing.
Okay.
In 2 hours. And I don't know why I rented it, because I just want something to play, and I brought it back. And I asked the lady who ran the shop, I was like, can I just get a new game? Because I kind of just beat it already, and I just got here, and she let me do it. And the second one was the first RPG I ever beat, and for a long time,
RPG.
The only one, Final Fantasy Mystic Quest.
Oh, sure.
So which is like super easy.
Yeah, yeah.
That was my favorite RPG for a long time, because I could actually beat it, and it wasn't insanely difficult or long. This is like classic, you know, Bone Dragon sort of setup.
Yeah.
But you don't really see that till here.
I definitely get the sense that, especially as hard as it's ramped up in the past couple stages, is you do get the sense that actually they were having more fun with the level design, with like the gameplay, like very early on.
Yeah, look how the background changed all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Like, this is cool. I really like they use. They really make you feel like you're going through an area. Whoa. Okay, nicely done. Now where are we? Forget this.
Okay. Oh. That's okay. That now we're at a checkpoint.
Finally.
Yeah.
This area looks fantastic. I love it.
This area is really cool. It's got and there's another vertical one you can drop through, and it's got destructible stairs.
Yeah, first time and only time, right?
Yeah. Oh, and the chunks hurt you.
But the thing is, they don't like. There's no point for you to do that.
No. It's when you're trying to whip the flying Medusa heads. If you're not careful about where you're whipping.
What jerks.
Yeah. Everything about this stage is a trick. I hate this stage so much.
Look at all the murdered skeletons in the background.
The tortured skeletons are twitching.
Catch that.
This is the low point in the game for me.
This screen?
This whole level, this whole section. And this is the last part before the boss, and it also sucks.
The spikes look different. The ones on the ground.
Oh, yeah.
This feels like Castlevania 3. Right here. Like the grotto you're in. Sort of classic.
Sure.
Like coffins, classic sort of coffin backgrounds. The skeletons are so goofy, though.
Yeah, just pawing, grasping at you. Okay.
I forget what this boss is.
Oh. This boss is a good one.
Is this the bat?
Nope.
Frankenstein?
Yes, it is.
Frankenstein's monster.
It's Frankenstein's monster. And he's not hard.
Right, of course. That's part of why they're showing you some of this. I feel like that's part of why they're showing you some of this classic visuals. Like, they're almost like psyching you up.
Yeah.
I was going to say, are you going to do a jump over? Like, you're a madman.
Oh, I shouldn't. I wish I could grab that knife. I really wanted the Banshee Boomerang. Okay, this is. Do not let up. If you do, you're dead. But if you just calmly crawl, you're good. Nice and slow. Don't care about candles.
This is why Summit Belmont has such like amazingly thick thighs. Because try crouch walking like that for that long. That's a serious workout.
I wish I had a tad more health, just to safety. But we should be good. I think this section right here sucks. Yeah, this section sucks.
This is just like
this
total
really
Mega
sucks.
Man style.
It's not though, because. It's random, and it's not a true pattern, so...
Okay, I'll be quiet. I'll just let you do it.
This sucks so much.
I believe in Jason Cannon.
Oh, my God.
Got that. Like, nothing.
Okay.
Come on. Look at those vicious spikes in the bottom. Like, they're... Love it. He's such a weird design, too. I just love how he looks. And there's the animation of his coat swinging. There's, like, a follow-through on his coat when he throws stuff. But, like, the color palette on him is super weird. Nice.
It's okay.
Nice.
Got him.
Come on, do something different.
Okay.
Entertain me.
That's the second best one.
I like that one better.
That's the second best one.
I like the motion of that one.
Is that, like, yeah, that kind of, yeah, wind up for the whipping. Okay, I'm glad we got through there. Now it's the best part of the game. This and the next level are the two best parts
Stage
of this game.
Nine. Graph Metal says, I love the way this game looks, but I actually think Castlevania 3 is the best looking Castlevania. I do agree that the sprite work on that is absolutely bananas. And I used to have strategy guides, like Nintendo strategy guides, just so I could study how they did all the weird backgrounds, because they're just so weird. This level's so weird.
This level's weird. And it's awesome. And this is my favorite track. This is my favorite music in the game.
This is... Yeah, they really use slopes on this a lot.
Yeah. And just, I love the Dracula's treasure room.
Yeah, so they never explain it, but it's just like, this is what he's been hoarding for centuries.
Yeah.
And you've just stumbled across it. But the ghosts are so funny because they just seem so out of place. You know, like everything
they
else is
kind of
fairly serious, like cool, and they're just sort of like goofy. Like goofy evil Casper ghosts.
They are kind of like evil Casper ghosts, yeah. And we've got gold skeletons.
Right.
We've got every platform is just shimmering. Everything's covered in gold.
Yeah, that's pretty
like,
cool.
I do really like this stage.
So Castlevania is basically like Scrooge McDuck. And we're just like swimming through his giant vault of money. Oh, come on, Super NES. You can do this. If this game had blast processing, I don't believe we'd be seeing such extreme slowdown. 5 out of 10.
It would sound terrible.
5 out of 10. Oh, don't even start with me.
Oh, man.
Just like
I'm
diamonds
missing...
hanging off the curtains.
Yeah, yeah. It's a nice touch. Everything. I think, this is definitely for another time when we eventually play it. But my favorite, just seeing the ghosts, reminds me of my favorite, I think my all-time favorite foreground screen effect.
Whoa.
Oh, good. Is in Donkey Kong Country 2, in the Hornet Hive stages. There's a full screen of dripping honey that covers the entire screen.
Interesting.
And it's really great. It's definitely my favorite. Probably my favorite full screen effect I've seen in a Super NES game.
Those backgrounds are like, what is the little wind holes just suck you in, right?
Yeah.
Like, what a weird enemy. They're just like, they stop making creatures, and now the environment is, like, Dracula's castle is so evil that the environment itself is trying to kill you.
Exactly. Just like what Mega Drive was mentioning earlier.
And I like the chests in the background. That's really cool. Mega Drive says, those are the ghosts of all the people Scrooge McDuck killed with his greed. This place is nothing but blood diamonds and just terrible things. I love that you actually get to see the floor of the, like, covered in gold and stuff.
Yeah.
And even all the swingy handle bits, as I think they're technically called, those are gold too.
Yeah, I'm good. I don't need those. Oh, this part also sucks.
I thought this was so neat.
It is really neat, but it can be annoying.
That's not bad. You got this, Ken. You got this. Oh, man. Those evil wall holes. But they don't do damage, right?
They don't do damage. They just hold you in place. They inconvenience you at worst.
Right. They're just not really... Yeah, they're not really used in a level design sense to make you... to put you at a disadvantage for other creatures.
Not really.
No, at least not so far. Is that a saber, like, up against the wall? Like,
yeah, yeah. Just like a rapier, just buried into the ground, a jewel encrusted sword.
Do you think Dracula eats jewel encrusted swordfish for dinner? To be like a super jerk?
Why would you say that? That's terrible.
Well, he doesn't sound like he cares about the environment or anything. He is literally a monster.
No, I'm definitely not happy with you saying jewel encrusted swordfish.
That's my new indie terrible. Band name, didn't you know? Huh.
I think I set myself up for a really tough jump, but I got out of it. Look at that.
Nice. You can't whip up while crouching, that's correct, right?
Yeah.
That'd be a nice touch. I feel like you could do some fun stuff with that. Oh, money bags. How appropriate that they start giving you money in this
game. All the candles give you money, only in this stage. Instead of like small hearts, you get money bags from almost all of them.
So funny.
And actually, I collected enough to earn an extra life, which is good.
Excuse me. Look at this madness.
Okay. This is the end of the stage. So this is much better. We got past my least favorite stage design. I'm really happy about it. I'm so psyched we're not in the dungeon anymore.
Dude, I wish the poor skeletons still trapped in the walls could say that. They've been there forever. They're like, you're just walking past them. They're like, man, you just don't even care. Oh yeah, it's like the jewel.
This is a fun take on a traditional Castlevania boss.
It's so simple, but because it's transparent and because it uses those spaces between the pixels, it just has this crazy depth to it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. It jewel does look really nice.
Chat, is there a name for this bat boss other than just Jewel Bat? I only know it as, like, Jewel Bat. It sounds like it's not a real word.
Oh, come on. Jewel Bat, please.
Jewel Bat, please. Oh, tiny bats. Nice. Stupid bat.
Done.
Mix it up.
Okay.
Oh!
Straight down.
Sugar!
I want to keep going because we're doing well. We're getting into the best parts of the game. This is what I've been waiting for.
Thank you, Graph Metal. It's Zap Bat. I knew it was something.
Zap Bat.
Zap Bat.
Amazing. And actually, it still allows you to keep control. It doesn't. It gives you control back. And then it takes it away again to auto walk up the stairs.
Oh, I didn't notice that.
Here and we now go. The true staple of a Castlevania game.
It's funny, like the tower that's in Rondo and Symphony of the Night, the exact same tower. Like it just looks exactly the same. Same green brick, the same shape.
Mm.
Here we go. Now we're doing the Castlevanias. They use the exact same technique as they did for the previous games for those wheels.
Yep.
Just move some sprites over and animate the background so it looks like it's all moving.
Yep.
I'm surprised they didn't do like Mode 7 stuff, but those probably would have been really big objects to move around.
And there's a lot of them.
Yeah. I think this stage does slow down a lot, though. There's quite a lot going on.
It does. There's a lot of background animation. Oof. There's a lot happening. Yeah, we're going to get a lot of slowdown. But this is still... This is a real. This is probably my favorite from a level design standpoint. There's really interesting stuff coming up, like talking about like you know evolution of a mechanic, and we're gonna see some really cool stuff coming up. That's really hard, but ultimately.
Oh, I was gonna
really
say this is where you do the you hang on the you become chainman. You hang from the chain and take a ride up, don't you?
Yep.
Whoa.
Okay. Sorry.
No, it's just like the game is just chugging.
Yeah. It's having a bit of a tough time.
It is dealing with a lot.
But it's like, yeah, everything in this stage moves. Chains in the backgrounds, gears as platforms.
I thought you said your Super NES was better than my Genesis. Can't even keep a stable frame rate. This isn't 1080p, this is only 940p. I'm starting a class action lawsuit. For a 25-year-old game. This is brutal. I find this just extraordinarily difficult. That's a really tough little bit.
This is one of the... Okay, I'm not going to get that. Because I have my double Banshee Boomerangs. But this part's pretty taxing. Because you got to hold on. And then you've got to deal with him because
nice.
He will knock you off almost all the time. If you just if you're not prepared for it and you just jump onto that platform, he's right there to just laugh at you and knock you right off.
It's like the man.
I want that.
Oh, triple shot.
Trips.
Is that supposed to be there? Oh, you just faded.
Oh, I forgot about that and paid the price.
That is crazy.
Okay, good.
This place is just falling apart. Dracula, get your team on this, buddy. Time to call the clock tower repairman. Look at this place, overrun with them. It's like this is where all your staff go when they're just like slacking off. And they just had their run of the place.
It's not a terribly long stage, too, especially compared to the last couple ones.
Actually, that's true. They're uneven in length, aren't they? Like, I find the first half of the game is much more better paced.
No.
Dude. Yeah. That's so tough.
That's okay. We're just back here.
That's like the Castlevania version of an elevator level in, like, a Streets of Rage game or beat 'em up, you know what I mean?
Sure.
You have to take an elevator up somewhere. Well...
Man, that Castlevania knockback.
Mega Drive BP says Dracula does what Nintendo don't. So good.
Luckily, they're nice enough they give you a dagger right here to deal with this part. Because you need something. You need a sub-weapon to throw.
Yeah.
Because you've got your Y button held down. You got your attack button held down.
Of course.
So that you can...
Nice. Oh, look at that. That was like action movie scene right there. You needed a little one-liner. The Medusa heads are the least egregious in this game, I think, than any of the Castlevanias. Maybe it's because they're bigger.
They are really big.
But I find their sine waves are slightly more pronounced. And maybe...
Sure, that's interesting.
I find them a little bit easier to predict.
Yeah, for sure. There we go.
I could be absolutely incorrect. But...
No heart.
Oh, look at
there
that.
There we go. Okay.
This guy's such a weird-looking design, too. Just his shading is weird. He sort of looks like slightly too chunky.
Okay.
Mega Drive BP says, man, I hate death planes that scroll up with you.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
That knockback gets you every time. Oh. Okay. This will be it for me for tonight. If I don't make this, we'll have to save it for another time. I'm going to practice up, and I'll do a full
run-through. Do a save state. Run through.
Forget.
I got to continue.
Oh, of course.
Do a save state when you get here. Can't go through the whole thing again.
That's true. Well, no, I'm going to practice up. I'm going to do a full run. Only full runs are pure. Oh, see, now...
Wait, what?
Oh! Yeah, I didn't get it in time.
Well...
Oh man, that's where we have to stop.
A1.
I think like that took a bit longer than I thought, but it was still good. I mean, we were talking a lot. That was really good though. That
man, Castlevania.
Castlevania. We'll be playing a lot more Castlevania in the future. Like we'll definitely be doing Symphony of the Night, and possibly Rondo.
Rondo, we have to do.
Rondo would be fun to do.
Marina only.
Will.
Marina Bird speedrun.
That's awesome. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in tonight to the Couchcast. Before we go, Ben, do you have anything to mention to plug while you're
I
here?
I might have something, yes. Sure. I just released my new game along with you, of which Mr. Jason Cannon was a part.
Yeah.
Okay. I just got released on PlayStation 4 and Vita, so it's up on the store now. Go get it. Play
yeah.
it. And message me on Twitter at Benjamin Rivers and tell me what you think about it. And tell me how bad I am at Castlevania 4.
tell me how bad I am at Castlevania 4 too, because I didn't do... I once again, apologies to Graph Metal for missing the secret room in the ballroom stage.
There's going
to
be
That's
a,
terrible.
There's going to be a debrief of meetings and video playback with lots of notes after this.
Most definitely. But thank you for joining us tonight, Ben. And this has been the Couchcast for August 25th, 2016. Thank you for tuning in, everybody, and we'll see you next week on the couch.